we're not wasting much ado. I want to call in my guest minister, since I'm standing here. And I'm going to read our profile. Our profile then. Before going to other declaration of things. Praise the Lord. I know you have it, Apostle. The other page. Reverend Blessing Ibukwe is married to an amazing, supportive husband, Roland Ibukwe. Praise the Lord. Amen. And they are blessed with 5 intelligent children. And they are rested right by your side there. Praise the Lord. Amen. She's a teacher. They live in Houston. A teacher, a preacher, a revivalist, a crusader, among other passion and giftings. She believes in miracles and in the life transforming impartation by the Holy Spirit, who is her closest friend and confidant, a graduate of business administration from University of Lagos, Nigeria. Reverend Blessing was tutored in ministry by a renowned teacher of God's word, Reverend Chris Okotin. Reverend Chris Okotin is the founder pastor of Household of God International, where Reverend Blessing served for over a decade and various capacities, including the head of hospital section, deliverance minister, Holy Ghost baptism minister, and so many more. Hallelujah. She attended LINC, she will tell us when she comes up here, Houston Bible School, Texas. Praise the Lord. Reverend Blessing, by the grace of God, is anointed to heal the sick, deliver the oppressed, and to teach the undiluted word of God. She is also strong, gifted in prayer, wisdom, administration, and carries the aura of God's presence. Hallelujah. Her life is a testimony of the exceeding greatness of God's power. As almost a decade barrenness was destroyed, and she is declared a God to be all-powerful. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I will rest this one, but I won't talk a little bit about her. I met her in a church. So when you meet people are very, very important. The person next to you has something you need. So look very well, very, very well, very, very, very well. When I first saw her, she was very close to my husband. I was like, who is this young woman? I didn't know she had kids. That's where she was looking. And she would just go around the church. And I kept my peace. And it came a day, she never told me she had a prayer thing, and I joined her prayer thing, and we became very close. Not only that, we ignited because of the work of grace of God upon our lives. And I really appreciate her. I was able to travel with her to California, Nevada, where I broke out for the ministry God has given to me. Since then until now, she has been very supportive. For somebody to leave her house and all that she's supposed to be doing, each year we come up to always support. I mean, I should. The Lord is very faithful. Amen.
Amen.
Not only that, when 2012 came for that I wanted to start and it was pressing, and I told her, look at what the Lord laid in my heart. He said, let us pray about it. Two of us came up with a revival fire conference at the same time. The fire and the revival. And this is why this ministry is better than that fire. Praise the Lord. So you're just not in an ordinary place, you're in a place of fire. And when fire comes, it consumes, it doesn't leave anything. So I believe God will consume every dross that is not of Him inside of you today in the name of Jesus. As each word keeps coming, at each section of time, even praise and worship, because we're going to have a session of praise and worship during offering, that the Lord is going to take away those heavy burdens, because that is His speciality. Praise the Lord. Today I introduce it to you, Reverend Blessing Ibukwe, as she comes up. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Can we bless the Lord for Pastor Francisca Bello? Wow. I believe we've had dinner. Hallelujah. Can we bless the King of Glory, the mighty God, the mighty, the awesome, awesome God, very God of the very good, one and the only potentate Jehovah is in the house tonight. Hallelujah, somebody. Amen. I want to appreciate everybody who's here. I want to appreciate my hosts, my big daughter in the Lord. I want to appreciate you, woman of God. I call her the general, mobile moving general. The strength of God is with you. You will fulfill destiny in Jesus' mighty name. I want to appreciate your husband who's always by your side, who's been there helping you out. And I saw Emmanuel out there doing the job. And And Mama is over there. Wow, appreciate God for the family. That's what it should be. My brother, I appreciate you. Thank you, sir. Thank you for all you do for the ministry. Thank you for the support you give your wife. Without it, she can't come this far. I'm a wife and I know that I've been in ministry for about 20 years. And my husband brought me to the Lord. And I know when I have to go, he'll just say, go. He'll take care of the kids and say, just go. Hallelujah. And so we want to appreciate what you do for the kingdom of God. I want to thank all the ministers in the house. I want to thank Grandma. I want to thank everybody at the charity. I see you here. I want to thank Mommy B. She came with me all the way from Houston. Wow, thank you. Appreciate that you can come support one of us. Because San Francisco, she's always in Houston. When we have stuff, she's there. And I'm glad that our women are beginning to, you know, come over to Dallas and to be a support. Thank you, Brother Felix, for always being here. Thank you so much. God bless you and your beautiful wife and your baby. I know she's unavoidably absent. I know I've seen man of God, of course. That's my big brother. I appreciate you, sir. I appreciate you. God bless you. Thank you for taking time to come be with us. And thank you for everybody. Hey, Minister Abena, it's been a long time, girl. You are ageless. I was just telling her, she's so ageless.
Yes,
thank
yes.
God for the grace of God. That was something else. That was powerful.
Yes, yes.
Thank God for the presence of God's Spirit. Thank God for all the ministers. Yeah, Minister Kendra, that was an awesome testimony.
Yes.
May the mighty hand of God rest upon your eyes for perfection.
Amen.
That which he began, may he be able to execute it in your life. In the mighty name of Jesus. Nahum 1:9 says, God has made an utter end and affliction will not rise a second time.
Amen.
We forbid it in the name of Jesus. I appreciate every woman of God in the house. Thank you. Thank you all so much for taking time to come. And I want to appreciate my head, my authority. That is my Lord and my King. That is my best friend. That is my mentor, my father in the Lord. He is my husband of 23 years. Can we just appreciate him for bringing us every year we have to come. He has to call off the job and get off schedule. And he brings us and our five beautiful children. And I just can explain the gift that you have been to me. Brought me to the Lord, mentored me through, handed me over to Jesus. And you're just such a big blessing. I appreciate you, sir. Love you. To the moon and back. God bless you. Hallelujah. Can we give the Lord a hand tonight? Hallelujah. We want to welcome the sweet Holy Spirit here. There is a song I want us to sing. As we sing the song, there is a power. See what Sister Abner was talking about. There's a presence in this place. And we're not going to undermine it. We're not going to minimize. We're going to allow the Holy Spirit just have a flow. Regardless of whatever the theme, whatever the title, we're not here for nobody. We're just here to seek God. And we're just going to honor him. There is this song. Last year in the school year, I had made petition for five of my kids because, you know, they were going to school and we took time. We always pray 1 month, you know, wait on the Lord for them for the school year. And they came back the first week of school and they broke out into testimony. When five people begin to talk to you at the same time, you know, it's a miracle. And everybody had a testimony to share. And they began to share the testimony and I just began to worship. And they were there and I started worshiping. I'm like, get me my phone, get me my recorder. This song is coming to me. And I recorded that song. And when I sing the song, it just reminds me of the miracle working power of God. Very simple. It says, Jehovah God Almighty is your name. Jehovah is your name. Mighty God is your name. The God that never fails. I don't know what it is you've believed him for. And it looks like, oh, it's taking too long. I waited about 10 years to have the first baby after marriage. But today I have five of them. It takes power. It is God. You may have been waiting for something, but that God never fails. That is what I'm saying. We're going to do this song. Brother Felix is going to help us. And as we do this song, I hear in my ear, someone is going to soon begin to write their own new song of testimony.
Amen.
You're going to receive a song of deliverance. You too, you're going to record it and say, God gave me the song in the day he broke through for me. Hallelujah. Jehovah God Almighty is your name. Jehovah is your name. Mighty God is your name. The God that never fails. Jehovah God Almighty is your name. Jehovah, you are mighty God is your name. Can I indulge you to just be upstanding? Let's do the song. Let's do it in faith. Let's do it prophetically. Let's do it symbolically. Let's do it like we believe it. Let's tell God you cannot fail regardless. No matter what I've been through, you will not fail. God Almighty is your name. You will not fail. Jehovah God Almighty is your name. Roshata. Mazetali brenda bosu kaliadaba. Mighty God, Adama Sukanda Kanada Boshadaba. What do you have, God Almighty? Without help, I am God. Before me, there was none, and after me, will never be another. Because I alone stand as God. That is the one we hallow tonight. That is the God we worship. The many-breasted God who has become the sufficiency of his saints. The awesome, foresome God. The God who Job would say he made the Orions, the Arcturians, the Pleiades, the chambers of the south. Mighty God is his name. Jehovah the healing God. The merciful God. The God of deliverance. His name is Jehovah Jesus. And he is here tonight to do only what he can do. Hallelujah. Only you can do what no man can do. I don't know why you're here. Hey, I just feel the power of God here to explode tonight. This is an unusual conference, people. It's an unusual conference. It's a conference that comes with a revival fire in it. Only you can do what no man can do, Jehovah. Only you can do. Come on, somebody, tell him. Ministry. Only you can do these things. We do not take them for granted. Tonight we have come to feed, oh God, on your table. We have come to dine at your feet. Speak for your servants here, oh God. Father, feed us through and through, oh God. And bring us to that green pasture, Lord, where we will eat, oh God, and never hunger again. The pasture of the word of God that is eternal. The word that abided and liveth forever. Thank you, oh God Almighty, that you've anointed our ears tonight that will hear the inaudible. And our eyes shall see the invisible. You grant our hearts, oh God, the grace to believe for the impossible. That your miracle, that which you do in our our midst tonight shall be permanent. We give you the praise, O God. Thank you as we cover this atmosphere, O God, with your mighty presence. And we say that which you do today only, you shall be glorified in the midst of your people. And your people declare thunderous amen. A mighty amen. An earthquaking amen in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Let's give it to the Lord. Give it to the Lord as you regain your seats tonight in the name of Jesus. Oh, thank you, Father. I just feel the oracular afflatus. It's the spirit of a preacher woman. But I'm going to say, Holy Ghost, help me tonight. I want to be able to preach a bit and teach a bit and let the Holy Ghost just flow. Hallelujah. Revive the fire in you. Hallelujah. Can someone get Jeremiah 23:29? Revive the fire. Hebrews 1:7 will tell us that God has made his angels spirit and his ministers a flaming fire. In other words, you are not looking for the fire. You have the fire. You don't even have the fire. You are fire. If he made his ministers a flaming fire, it means that you are fire. But tonight he is saying, do you know you can be hotter than you are? Can somebody just talk to me tonight? He said you are fire, you carry fire, but your intensity, just like the light, can brighten. Your degree can increase. Your degree can expand, hallelujah. Because we all have lights. You see how beautiful this place is. Now, but may I tell you, there are some things on this floor you still cannot see because you needed this place brighter. Not because they don't exist, but because the degree of the brightness is not enough to picture some objects.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
And that is the difference between any two believers. Hallelujah. One carries the glory of a certain light to a certain degree. The other carries another degree of that light. And sometimes you'll be wondering, but why is it that their lives, they believe the same word, talk the same word, preach the same word, but sometimes there's disparity. The degree of intensity.
Yes.
And so you already fire. I did not come talking to a people who were looking for where is the flame. Hebrews 1:7 said, you're already a flaming fire. But may I tell you that when the fire is on and the flame is on, you will need a certain strength of the wind to determine the direction of the flame.
Yes.
Holy Ghost, help me now. You're gonna need a certain degree. When the wind blows in a certain area, then the flame scatters abroad, right? When there is no wind, the fire stays. Well, may I tell you, the Holy Ghost is here to blow up that flame. He is the wind and the breath of God that blows your flame. So the flame scatters abroad. Hallelujah. It's not my word like as a fire, say the Lord. Hallelujah. Jeremiah 23:29. Yes, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Say the Lord. And like the hammer that shatters the rock into pieces. The power of God will. His word is fiery. That's what it says. He said, my word is fiery. My word is fire. So that when he says, revive the fire in you, what God is saying is get the fire in you to the outside so it can become the fire on you. Hallelujah. You don't understand it yet. It has to be a fire on you. Because until it's on you, nobody else can see it. When it is in you, it is contained, it's confined, it's constrained. And the Bible says on the day of Pentecost, that's why the cloven tongues of fire came and sat on them. Hallelujah. And revival broke out because it's on them. So when you are reviving the fire, because we're gonna get up here, we're gonna do some moving in the spirit, and the spirit of God is just gonna magnify Jesus in this place. And that time is gonna be the time to birth on the inside until the fire comes to the outside and it becomes a fire upon you, no longer a fire in you. Hallelujah. He says, it's not my word. Let's see that word in Judges chapter number 6 tonight. It's not my word. God likened his word to the fiery fire. It's not my word like the fire. You know what the fire does when it enters. I mean, nobody see. When the fire comes to a place, nobody will tell you there is fire. You will know. You will feel the heat.
Amen.
You will feel. I mean, God can be here. You're wondering, is he here? You will know. Hallelujah. You gotta know it, sir. Let's look at the life of one man who encountered the word of God and who saw the fire of God even in his timid state. So that you may just be here, someone will think, but I'm despondent. Oh, this melancholy all around me. I'm just in a state, you don't understand, in a confused state. No. We will see the life of a man. Judges chapter number 6 is a man whose account you know in the Bible. His name is Gideon. He was a fearful man because the Moabites has attacked them and they're spoiling their food and they're spoiling their crop and taking away their harvest, and there was famine in the land by a reason of enemy. I don't know what kind of enemy had besieged you, and it looked like this enemy is such a threat that you just can't do the things you used to do. They couldn't go to their own vineyard to press their wine no more. They couldn't go to their farms to harvest their crops no more. Now this is their legitimate ground, their sphere of authority, but suddenly something happened. And sometimes you're in your territory, your area of jurisdiction, but yet you're handicapped. And you're wondering, but I have a legal ground, I have a legal standing, but how come I can operate? I just can exercise full authority because something, a strange thing was happening in the land. And the Bible told us that the Midianites would gather, and Gideon was fearful. The description he would give God, we're going to read it, chapter number 6, verse 18 and 21, I'm going to read it in a short while. The Bible described him as a fearful young man who was hiding to go into his own father's vineyard. Are there times you have by stealth now, not by confidence, by stealth, the things that normally should belong to you, that you should be bold about, suddenly you can't talk about them, you can't brag about them no more. It's like you're sneaking up on yourself because there is a situation, because there is a circumstance. Hey, tell somebody, fire is coming on them. Fire is coming on them. Fire is coming on them. La-da-da-ba, shata, break it, tables. Woo! Fire is coming on them. And the Bible said God began to speak to this young man when he went in the press to hide that thing from the Moabites. And God said to him, hey, mighty man of valor. The entrance of his word. He looked around, said there must be a great big man here. There must be someone formidable. And the Spirit of God said, it is you. He said, oh no, you don't know my resume. You don't know nothing about me. Go and ask, inquire. I am the least in my father's house. In my father's house too, he is the least. I mean, we're just on the last of the food chain. We're just the least. We're just no good. We're just bottom. Isn't it just like God to go to the least? Isn't it like God to use the base things? Isn't it like God to use the dejected? Hallelujah. Isn't it like God to go to the place where you are last in number so he can make you first so that no man glories? Hallelujah. Isn't it just like God? Hallelujah. Isn't it like God? I have this testimony. Before we read this, Judges 6. One of the days, it was last year, my son had qualified for one thing in school and they had conference to give them orientation in school. I had gone there late. It was supposed to be like 9 o'clock. I got there maybe past 10. It was a Saturday morning. I run the prayer line, 6 a.m. And at times I'm done prayer and I counsel. And then that day my daughter was going to get the State of Texas Award. And so I had to get the kids ready, get up prayer line, get the kids ready. Well, I got there very late. And I got into that place very late. I was the last person. That place, that hall was packed full. And so the announcer had gone around the orientation and all that. They were rounding up and they're like, okay, we have this gift here for the first parent who stepped into this place. I just feel God is shifting some things for someone tonight. And he arranged for you to be here. Not an accident, because there's no circumstance with God. Everything God does is by predestination. Because he sees the ending from the very beginning. And I got in there and I sat down. And the announcer suddenly said, well, we're about to round up, and not before the first parent who get in here come pick their gift. And they called the person's name, because apparently they took it off of the register. And they called and waited and nobody showed up. And the lady said, okay, the second parent, please come pick up this gift. Come pick up this gift right quick. And then they waited. Oh, may my God showcase somebody. May my God showcase somebody. And they waited and nobody showed up. And the announcer suddenly went, well, you all know we have beautiful parents. We have very hardworking parents, you know. And some of our parents are just extra hardworking. Some of our parents just take more time with the kids and just take more time with family. And some of our parents just do so much. They get so busy and because they do so much, sometimes they run late. Can the last parent to come in here come pick the gifts? Hallelujah! Hey, somebody tell somebody favor is unfair. Favor is unfair. Hallelujah! Can the last parents who entered here step up and pick up your gift? Are you kidding? hidden me. I wasn't a proud last parent. I wasn't proud. I didn't want anybody to know I was last. And suddenly the hall erupted. People started to clap. Have you seen people who sat there for 2 hours before you came clap for you? To go pick a gift that they deserved. But that is happening to somebody as I'm speaking to you tonight. In the name of Jesus. When that comes, last before you're coming for us. It is called favor and it's not fair. And I got up and the officer came to her. I was like, oh, I'm not proud to be last. She said, oh, come on, get up, you deserve it. And parents were clapping. And they clapped until I went to the podium and I picked my gift and they clapped back. Tell me that God does not see in the secret and reward in the open. Because in the natural eye, oh, she's there. And you know what God, the table God is going to set before you, such that no gainsayer.
Amen.
I mean, the people who should be upset were applauding. You know why? Because the announcer made me look like one extra hardworking mother. God already prepared the table in the midst of accusations and in the midst. And they were like, wow, she must be very hardworking. Of course, I left the prayer line. I must be hardworking. I said to myself, I'll be counseling God's people. I must be hardworking. Hallelujah. And so will you be rewarded. Hallelujah. That is for somebody who will believe tonight. Hallelujah. It is a radical moment and it's a time for believing. Hallelujah. And the last parents. I don't know what number you are on the chain. Doesn't matter. I don't know what number. I don't know who said you can go so far. My God in my dialect, we call them Ojijijima. Means you got the yam, you got the knife. Nobody tells you where to go from. You determine who comes first. You determine who comes last. Your pedigree don't determine your qualification, not your accent, not your color. God got the yam on one hand. He got the knife. So he can decide, I'm going to cut you to be head. Nobody can query that. They can only gruntle. I'm going to cut you to be middle. I'm going to hallelujah, because he's God and God all by himself. He does as he pleases. Sovereign God. Mighty God. Woo! And I left that place that day. I was just worshiping God. I said, is this how heaven will be on that day when they say the first shall come last? Because in the natural, if that gift was 100, you know you wouldn't get it because you're probably 101. You are probably 101. I carry a favor that I come to release for somebody here tonight.
Yes.
May you be favored.
Yes.
Some years ago, I was going to line up with the kid, just had a baby, going to get this sauce, and I just needed it desperately. And we went late, you know, before you carry all of the children line, they are counting for you, want to everybody get out of the car before you, oh my goodness, I got there late. And suddenly they are like, oh, today we're sorry, we're not going to be closing at 12, at 2, we'll leave at 12. Please, we're going to hand out this blue card. Wherever it stops, that's the last place. Everybody can come next year. I said, God, I can't come next year. I can't just have a new baby. I need this, like, I need it right now. Well, the security man started passing it. He was passing it, and he got to me, and he said, yes, ma'am, you're last. I said, God, I will make heaven no matter how late. That was my confession. I said, God, help me. He handed me the last. He said, here you go, ma'am. May God qualify you.
Amen.
Amen.
No man can give what they don't have.
Amen.
The favor and the grace of God on my life, receive it.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Woo, shatalada brisketi. I feel such anointing in this place. People of God must have been praying. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jeremiah, chapter number, come on, where are you now? Chapter number 6. Judges. Judges chapter number 6, where are you? Verse number 18. I prefer reading from my Bible. Sometimes your key locks you up out of your device. Oh yeah, Judges. Okay, I got it. The Bible told us, I'm going to be reading from verse number 18. Hallelujah. And this young man, because, I mean, this is a man who knew himself. And God says, you're mighty. He knew he was a mighty. Discourse with God. And God was just telling him. And God was reviving the fire that is on the inside of him. He didn't even know he had the fire. We know we have fire. He didn't know it. God had to remind him over and over and over. And in verse number 18, he said to the Lord, he said, depart not hence, I pray thee, until I come unto thee, and bring forth thy presence, and set it before thee. And he said, I will tarry until Now, and Gideon went in and made ready a kid and unleavened case of an ephah of flour, and the flour he put in a basket. He put the broth in a pot, and he brought it out unto him unto the oak, and he presented it. And the angel of the Lord said to him, take the flesh and the unleavened case, and lay them up upon the rock. And he poured out the broth, and he did so. Before that verse, I want you to see one verse. Good. Verse 17. And he said unto him, if now I have found grace in thy sight, then show me a sign that thou talkest with me. If I have found grace in your sight and you are promising me all of these things, give me a sign that you talk with me. In other words, give me a proof of the power of your word. Give me a proof. It's not like my word like a fire. I'm trying to connect it for someone. Give me a proof. If all of these things were saying, indeed you have called me a mighty man of valor, indeed I found favor, I found grace, give me a token. Sometimes you don't ask for token as believers. Sometimes we don't even ask for confirmation. He said, give me a token. And then the Bible said the angel told him, pull the flour and pull the flesh and then pull them underneath. And Gideon did that. And he said, and the angel said unto him, take the flesh, and he did that. Then the angel of the Lord put forth the end of the staff that was in his hand and touched the flesh. This is where I'm going. And he touched the flesh and the unleavened cake, and there rose up fire out of the rock and consumed the flesh and the unleavened cakes. Then the angel of the Lord departed out of his sight. He said, give me a proof of your word. And God proved the presence of his word by fire. Yeah, 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 yeah. God says, I'm going to prove myself by fire, by the things you understand, by the way I have led you, for the way your forefathers have known. I'm the God who consumes by fire, not by flood, not by water. And the Bible said, but God did something. He touched the flesh. Hallelujah. He touched the flesh, and he ate the flesh up by fire. Until the flesh is eaten up by fire, there's no revival.
Amen.
Until the flesh, he said, present the flesh. You want me to revive the fire within me, then you got to present your flesh. Come to me as you are. Tell me that weakness. Let me know that addiction. Tell me the struggle. Open the fear before me. Let me see the flesh in you. Because I'm about to touch the flesh. If I don't touch your flesh, if my fire don't come on it, then there's no revival. And we will see, because of this encounter, a fearful Gideon. The Bible said by the next morning, his people will not believe what he did. Hallelujah. In the land, what he had done to the house of Baal. A guy who felt he was nothing. He couldn't even stand up because he think, I'm the least. I mean, I'm not legal. I am not qualified. I don't have the accent. I don't have the pedigree. I'm not tall enough. I'm not cute enough. Excuse me, says who? Says who? Who told you your destiny requires cuteness to accomplish? Canada Bush. I wrote a new book. It's coming out next weekend. We're launching it. It's You Are Beautiful. God says, tell my people, that beauty is not what you look like physically. He says you're beautiful by default because you're made in my nature.
Yes.
I am a beautiful God.
Amen.
So who's telling you what you believe in?
Right.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Who has told you? Meanwhile, it was fear that told Gideon. Fear made him start confessing, I am not strong, I am weak, I am the least, he started compromising. Wherever you have been to, and situations have made you compromise, by the power of God in this place, I decree you're coming out of it.
Yes.
You will answer the name God call you.
Yes.
Moab called him fearful.
Amen.
The least in my father's house, because there was a Moab situation. I challenge every Moab situation in your life.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. Every gang up of evil. Situation made him begin to confess negative. I'm small. I'm little. I'm no good. I can't do it. Why? Because there's no money in your account? Who told you need all that money to do it? The just must live by faith.
Amen.
Hallelujah. No faith, no life.
That's right.
When you're a Christian, you don't have faith, you're not living, you're not alive. Period.
Amen.
Ah, I don't have money then. Oh, he hasn't called me. Maybe then he doesn't love me. Really? Hallelujah. Hey, God wants to speak to somebody today. And the Bible said the angel of the Lord stretched forth that rod and touched the flesh. That was what Jesus told them. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. They went to the upper room in Acts chapter number 2 and they tarried there. We're still going to come to that place, and they tarried at that place. What were they doing? They were putting the flesh down. The flesh don't want
to be in one place for too long. Your flesh don't want to be in bondage. The flesh don't want to be. That's why you see when people are bad and they commit crime, they incarcerate them. Because the flesh hates to be put away. The flesh hates, lock it up one place, you're not interacting with nobody, no social media. The flesh can't stand it. That is why when you fast and you can fast your eye, fast your speech, fast food, fast everything, you're mortifying. The flesh cannot take it. And if you're able to subdue it, that is the power of the Spirit.
Amen.
That is how people begin to rise in the place of the Spirit.
Amen.
Because fasting just helps you beat down the flesh. It helps you consume it, like what the angel did. He said, bring the flesh, I'm going to consume it. Then we saw a fearful Gideon became a warrior. Do you know he didn't win that battle by strength? Can you stop looking at your strength? Don't look at what you're able to do. All the things you were able to do, how many have you done really? If it's going to be by your ability. All of your intellect put together, all the technical know-how, all the contacts of the people on your list, how has he helped? The man did not even overcome by fighting. He didn't lift a bow, he didn't lift a weapon. He just carried a torchlight and took some noisy stuff. The Lord said, cross over to your people. You are here thinking you are small. Let me show you what people think of you. Hallelujah. He is here afraid. Oh, I cannot. God said, cross over. And then when he was going to cross over, God understands your situation. That is why he's going to revive us tonight.
Amen.
Even though he was still afraid, God said, okay, I understand. You can't go alone, right? Take your assistant. He understands afraid. Take your, it's not the God that will say, oh, I called him mighty man of valor, you're still afraid. Now I say, cross over, you still can't go. I'm going to go look for, no, a tough macho. No. He said, I understand you're still fearful. I permit you to take help. But cross over that you may hear. And he crossed over, and this guy had dreamt, and he was telling the dream, and they say, the meaning of your dream is not other than mighty Gideon. Was that not what God called him?
Yes.
He won't believe until a man will reiterate it.
Amen.
Yes.
He said, this dream means nothing else. Haven't you heard about the sword of Gideon and the sword of God? Then when he heard, may you hear what will stir your faith.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Yes.
When he heard, he said, really? Is that me? That has always been you. Even when you were shaking, that was you.
Yes.
When you were so afraid and palpitating and couldn't sleep at night, that was your reality. You just didn't know it. When you were putting anointing oil on every roach in the name of witch, that was your reality. God has elevated you above principalities and powers. Last week, God was telling us, he said, I elevated you. He said, you see, powers and principalities, they are so mean. They rule, they dominate unbelievers, they dominate the cosmos. He says there are some group of them, their job is to determine what street an accident must happen the next week. They determine what house must be on fire. They determine, God says, it's okay, let them legislate. The balloting is of man, disposal is of God. Let them gather. Now, because I've elevated you above them, when they finish their meeting, you just get up and make one prophecy, everything shatters. But the thing is, will you prophesy, child of God? Will you prophesy to the dry bone like Ezekiel? Will you speak? Or will you say, oh, they have come again. If Jesus complained about the fig tree, it won't dry up. Too many complain. Oh, he said that fig tree deceived me. I was heading to north. The tree looked like it was green and I was hungry. I had to leave north and go to south. Only to get to south and there was no food. What kind of useless tree? Can you curse it? Because if not, the next week you would have forgotten you went through that rat. It would beckon on you. Only for you to get there and say, were you not the same tree last week? You don't have that time to be gallivanting. Too much complaint. Why? Because the revival fire is not stirred up on the inside. Elisha collected the double portion of anointing when he was coming. The little youth, they say, look at you, bald-headed, prophet indeed. Look at how you were dressed. The Bible says he cursed them in the name of the Lord.
Yeah.
I look at that scripture, I'm like, oh my goodness, God. This guy, the first test of that power was to part the River Jordan. The next test of his double portion of anointing, the Bible says in the name, the Bible did not say he commanded bears to eat them. All you have is to prophesy. Doesn't matter how God does it. He cursed them in the name of the Lord, and two female bears ate up 42 children in an instant because someone made an utterance. Someone made an utterance from the place of the stirring, from a place of the death, from a place that is revived already, from a place of faith.
Never been tested, never proven, didn't know it would work. Wasn't even thinking it would work, he was just angered. Can you get angry enough at the devil?
Hallelujah.
Can you get revived enough in the spirit and say, hey, this status quo got to change. And it is changing today.
Amen.
Tomorrow is too late. I'm not even going to wait till tomorrow.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Is not my word like fire, says the Lord. Is not my word like fire?
Yes.
Too many flies perching on pots because they are not hot. You put a hot pot here, the flies will go on, they can't fetch them. They can't, they're demons. They can't perch. But if it's not hot, they'll have a field day. And only revival can stir up the hotness in the believer. Only the revival fire on the inside, to the point where that revival fire comes on top of you. If it's not on top, nobody will see it. No impact. Only you will know, I have decided to follow Jesus. Only you know that. Nobody knows what you decided until they can see the results.
Hallelujah.
When they see your result, then they will know what you have decided. Then you affect other people. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Revive the fire in you. Nobody else will do it. Nobody will say, oh, sister, I'm coming to revive your fire tomorrow. And you cannot say, God, revive my fire, revive. God have told you, the scripture is clear. There are things that don't answer to prayer. Just stop praying. We're too religious about prayer. Prayer is good. I've been praying for 2 years. I love prayer. My mom told me when I was two, they just used to put me on, you know, stuff. And people lined up in my house. I just used to lay hands on them. My aunt asked, what language am I saying? They say baby language. But they won't go until you pray. So I've been praying all my life. So I'm a person, but please. Recently, God said, tell my people, I am not prayerful, I am faithful.
Amen.
If they pray, let there be faith in the prayer, otherwise I don't hear them. I am not called a prayerful God, I'm called a faithful God. God would rather you be full of faith and keep quiet, things will happen. Than you speak a million words and there is no faith. He's not moved. Hallelujah. So I'm not prayerful, I am faithful. I am full of faith.
Yes.
And so we have likadadaba, jatalaba, zededebo, zi, and you just pray. Now what did God say? Nothing. It's a monologue. That's not a portion. God is a speaking God, and I'm going to show that to you when we move over to how do you revive the fire? Because we all need it revived. We all need it. Hallelujah. How do I revive the fire? How do you revive your fire? I've told you, you're not looking for fire. Except as an unbeliever, but may I even tell you, even an unbeliever have their own kind of fire. And they produce results with their own kind of fire. And we see their own kind of results, and sometimes we are jealous. They have results. They are succeeding in their sphere. You may be there, castigate them all you like, but they are succeeding. And this one who know how they got the money, well, but they are rich. And this one who know, look at the account, but they got it. Don't you wish to get it? You wish to. Okay, you now that know the right way to get it, can you get it the right way? Let's see it. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do something and get it the right way. Then let's see your right results.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, stop. Don't talk to them. Don't say, don't even bother with a fake pastor. No. The fake pastors prosper because the good ones keep quiet.
Yes.
Your only contention against them is what Elijah did against the prophets. Well, come here, let's contest. Let's see if God be God. Otherwise, keep quiet. Hallelujah. Otherwise, keep quiet. Is somebody getting blessed tonight? Hallelujah. So how do I revive the fire of God in me? Number one, listen. Listen. The Bible says in Proverbs 20:12, the hearing ears and the seeing eyes, God have made them both.
Yes.
Listen. Every man or woman in the Bible who was revived and became relevant in God's scheme of things heard God.
Yes.
And God told Noah, build an ark. Because he was paying attention. And God said to Abraham, come out of all the Chaldeans. He heard because he was paying attention. In fact, God told Abraham, go kill Isaac. Give him up as a burnt offering, sacrifice. He heard God. At the point where he tied this young lad and was raising the knife in his hand, he heard God again. He did not say, oh, I have already heard God. Then my ears are blocked because God has spoken. God doesn't speak once. God is such a speaking God. He spoke from Genesis to Revelation. He spoke so much that in Hebrews, the Bible called the blood of the new covenant a speaking blood.
Yes.
In fact, when the blood will not even continue to speak because Jesus had to shed the blood and go back, he sent the Holy Ghost to live in us and continue speaking.
Yes.
God is ever speaking. When you turn your radio and you say, oh, I've heard the news. Everybody come and hear what's happening in the news. Well, may I tell you, the news has been going on even when you didn't. You only heard it because you tuned in. God never stops speaking for one day. Hallelujah. So we have to listen. He says, the hearing ears and the seeing eyes, I made them both. In other words, he has given you eyes that see and ears that hear. So what are you hearing and what are you seeing? In Revelation chapter 1, there was one of the apostles. He was in the Isle of Patmos. He was sent there, you know, to go die. John, we know the story. The Bible said that was not a rendezvous. It wasn't a funfair. That was even not just a prison. If you go to prison, you see other people. That was an island. Was confined to death. Yet in that place, he heard God. There is no situation where you can't hear God. Whether you are lonely, whether in the midst of a crowd, anywhere you go, even underneath the depth of the ocean, God speaks. And he speaks loud. And everything with his autograph, he hears him. The Red Sea heard God and parted. The Bible says when God shows up, the mountains keep us round. I didn't see their eye, but they saw God. Because everything he made bears his autograph. And so must we. And so he said, the hearing ears, the seeing eyes, I made it. And if we must be revived, you must hear. There is something about the word of God. Look at Gideon. Because God spoke to him, a fearful Gideon became a mighty warrior. Why? Because he heard. That's why Romans 10:17 is telling us, faith comes by hearing, by the word of God. You will hear God say, do some things. And when you're done, you'll be wondering, how did I get the boldness to do it? Because the word is anointed. When you hear the word, you're empowered to do. When that word comes from God, suddenly shackles are broken, suddenly your fears and your limitations are gone, and you'll be wondering, I really did it. Yes, because you heard and you acted in that moment. Hallelujah. So we must deliberately on purpose. Don't say, oh, if God wants to speak to me, he will speak regardless. Well, he's been speaking regardless. Oh, if he just barges in here and something happens, I will know the mighty wind of the Holy Spirit is blow. We know. You're a free moral agent. You have the right to choose. God is not going to violate that. He's a God of order. In other words, if you don't want to hear, it's up to you. If you want to hear, it's up to you. So you first decide, Lord, I've come to the place where I want to hear you. I want to be able to determine your voice. In fact, I don't know the use of a believer who's still on earth if they can't hear God. There is no point. Because how do you get direction? How do you get direction? How do you know where you're going in this journey that you've not been here? The one who's been here before will show you. So if you can't hear the direction, it says take left and right. How are you surviving? How are we getting by? Hallelujah. And sometimes it looks like there's just no difference between us and the unbeliever. Because we're as confused as them. They don't know to go left or right. And we too were asking them for direction. Did you go left or right? And they're wondering, really? Hallelujah. May God help us. But when we're revived, the Bible says we are the light. We illuminate. They look at us as we're going. They can see so they can know where to go. They can know where to go. And it comes by hearing. And he said, I have given you the hearing ear. So listen. That you may hear. Hallelujah. Listen that you may hear. Number two, tarry in God's presence. I love that. God says, no, not pray. Tarry, because there's a difference between tarrying and praying. When you pray, you go to just tell God stuff. One-way traffic. God, I'm going to work. I thank you. Cover myself with your precious blood of Jesus. See me through today and bring me back safely in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So what did he hear? Did he tell you he's going to see you through and bring you back? Did he tell you as you're going? Did he tell you where to go? Did he tell you what? That's a discussion. Prayer is a two-way thing. You're talking to God. It's called prosuke. You're coming face to face with God. And when you come before a speaking God, he answers. You will know. You can't get up for prayer and be wondering, should I go left or right? No, you haven't prayed through. So tarry in the presence. In Isaiah 40, let's read Isaiah 40, verse 31. You're going to see what happens when we tarry in that place. And that is revival. That's the direct impact of revival. Isaiah 40, the last verse 31. Hallelujah. It's a scripture we know and I read. He says, the day that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and shall not faint. When you see the firefighters combating fire, then you will see the reality of this scripture. When you see the tenacity, the aggression of fire, that conflagration, when it comes in his mind, I mean, it is hard. That's what the Bible is saying. If you wait upon the Lord, you become such a flaming fire that no matter where, I mean, they can't capture you. Where are they going to start to begin to tame you? Where is the enemy going to capture you? Where can you enter a flame from? A blazing flame of fire. When we wait upon the Lord, you are going to renew your strength. Some of us, we are not, you know, revived because we're just weak. We're just tired, no strength.
Yes.
Dissipated.
Yes.
No energy, no zeal. No passion. The Bible says the zeal of God that performs his counsel. In other words, because we lack zeal, his counsel is not performed.
Right.
And we say, Lord, let your counsel stand. Then he said, I need my zeal to make it work. Where is my zeal in you? I can't see no zeal, I can't perform nothing. Hallelujah. Just like when Jesus would go to Bethany, the city of Bethany, when Lazarus had died. No matter how powerful he was, it's Jesus. Until they rolled the stone, nothing, no miracle will happen.
Yes.
No miracle. You have your end of the bargain, you must do it, you must fulfill it. He told them, well, I understand your plight, you have been tired. Sometimes God comes to you and makes a man where you think, Lord, I don't have money now, you say so. Lord, I'm just so tired, you say, arise. Lord, I've just finished this well, that is when it must be by faith. Because he don't need your flesh doing nothing. Because he will take glory if you did it.
Yes.
If he comes to you when you're 100%, then you say, Lord, oh my goodness, did you just see me on the podium? Sometimes he makes sure you go into that exam at a 50% level. And he tells you, I'm the 100% God that we crown you. So when you get that license in your hand, you know to celebrate him and say, it wasn't me. It was all God. Because no flesh glories in his presence. Hallelujah. And so when we learn to tarry in his presence, what is tarry in his presence? Is have sweet fellowship, sweet communion. You can have your quiet time early, just spend time with him. Not necessarily prayer. You might not even be loud. You might not even, you're just admiring this God, envisioning the wife, the throne, and his mercy seat. And you know, just loving on God and just opening yourself into this wonderful romantic relationship with the person of the Holy Spirit. And just tarrying in the presence of God for that outpouring of his fire, for that outpouring of his revival. And you would know it when you get to that breaking point. It's not because prayer is us, but tarry is God. When you pray, I want something, give me. But you see, God is so smart. He takes away himself from everything he gives you. Why? So you can come back. Lord, I want a baby. You're going to have your hands full. Then you realize God is not in the baby. He's God. He's not substituted for your big mansion.
Yes, yes.
Your car did not replace him. After 2 years, you're like, the novelty is worn out. God, where are you? Hallelujah. Amen. Tarry takes you back to seeking God on a consistent basis. Because prayer, Lord, is a one-time thing. If you answer me, bye, see you later. That's prayer. You go because you have a need. So if he answers your need, what are you praying for again? Hallelujah. Yeah, I have an item, 3 items, and I say, God, I'm coming to pray, and they are all checked. Hey, thank you, Lord. Maybe the next 1 month, I'll come and say good morning, sir. But tarry is not praying to get anything. It's a fellowship time. It's a time where you take all of the Holy Spirit, where you build this connection. This one of my greatest blessings with God is the ability to generate his presence. So just stay in the presence of God. I mean, you can't trade it for anything. In the presence where you don't need to bind. When the evil spirit from God tormented King Saul, and that teenage boy David enters, nobody laid hands on leg. No binding and no uprooting. The Bible said the spirit, the demons left the way they came. In the presence of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It left the way he came because no power can survive the presence. As darkness in Genesis chapter 1. The Bible said God had looked at this tohu bohu, this chaotic situation, disorder, when the darkness had paralyzed the entire earth, frozen it up. And God had been looking at this until the day, the Bible said, the sweet Holy Spirit left a certain place to hover on another place. May he hover over your situation. God did not have a darkness issue. His problem wasn't darkness. What God needed was to generate a presence, period.
Yes.
You don't have a witchcraft issue. You don't have a marital issue. Just bring the presence of God into that home. That is all you need. No power has been able to survive it. No resistance has been able. Darkness, the minute the Holy Spirit came down, and hovered upon the surface of the earth, and God knew, noticed a change in the atmosphere. Sometimes our problem is we don't know when our atmosphere shifts.
Yes.
And sometimes he just brings impacts my heart. You go to church and the word of God comes out and the word is power. I'm a deliverance minister. And at times I'm seeing all of those demons running amok and I'm just seeing all this. And in the power of that word, I'm just saying, Lord, Lord, take it to the next level. And somehow the words just dissipates. And you'll be wondering, why was all that presence generated? Why was it generated? And people go back with the same antenna.
Yeah.
Why was the presence generated? When God sends the presence, He spoke. He activated it.
Yeah.
Sometimes we don't know when there's a shift in the spirit. Because God does not live everywhere. He inhabits the presence.
Yes. Yes.
Your own is to create. Once you can create a presence, you will not lack a revival. Yes. That was the first lesson I learned as a young believer. He said to me, never speak a word of prayer until you sense my presence. Do not. Because then you just speak into the air. In fact, he used the scenario of the, we call them the witch doctors back in Africa. And it made sense. That was what he said to me. He said, when a family goes to the witch doctors and said, oh, I want protection for my family. I want prosperity. And the witch doctor will do incantation. And God showed me, it's like a movie. And God was showing me. He said, what he's doing is he's calling out a presence. He has no power except there's a presence. God says he's calling out a presence, and that presence is going to be embodied by a spirit which the natural eye can see. And God says, he says, when that presence comes, he will assign that presence to go with that family and tell the person your job is done. But if the presence could not be generated, that they will tell them, go and come back in 7 market days. And the person don't know, why do I have to come back in 7 market days? So he can do more consulting. Because they can't work without a presence. It's a spiritual law. He's a spirit. You cannot walk outside of a presence. When you go to the club, the nightclub, or to all of these crazy places, sometimes you say, oh, I'm not in the mood, I'm not going to dance. You can almost swear, I am not going to dance. You just get in there first. There is a presence that takes you off of your seat when you don't know it. And you are dancing before you know you are dancing. Because at that time, there is a presence. There is power in the presence.
Yes.
When the lights begin to blink, I've never been in there before. God showed me like a movie. He showed me this is what happens. It's beyond that control of that person because the atmosphere is greater than the man. The atmosphere is greater than the man. And so that's why it's important for you to know the atmosphere you stay under.
Yes.
Very key. When they get there, they can say, oh no, play the music you like, whatever the light flickers, I'm not getting up. Before you know it, they are nodding. Before you know it, the person who vowed at home that I'm not dancing, I just want to hang out. Oh, they dance and they're begging them, can you take it easy? Can you, you're just on my space, please now, can you see them? But they were so sure they wouldn't dance. What happened to them? The atmosphere.
Yes.
Kadabashitibos. And so when David went there to tarry, that's what he went into the presence. He wasn't even looking at Saul. David will go and start playing. A man after God's heart. He know how to stir the spirit of God. And he will tarry in God's presence. And he will invoke the power of his presence. And the minute God begins to rise in the power of his presence, the demons on the king begin to leave him. The demons will retract. They will just do backstep. And they go out. Nobody outside bind you. Because the presence binds them. Nobody say I lose because the presence lose them. Second Kings chapter 3, Jehoshaphat was going into that battle with the other two kings and they expended everything. And he says, there's no man of God, there's no food, no supply. When they got to the mighty man of God, see the request of the man of God. Imagine this is a prophet that can just wake up from sleep and say, hey, water, spring forth. Is a mouthpiece of God in Israel. But look at the condition he gave them. He said, bring me a minstrel. If you don't play, if there is no stirring, if the presence doesn't generate, it's not sorry, I can't help you. That is a already known established national prophet.
Amen.
So if a man so anointed by God, who represents God with every authority and backing on earth, we need a presence of God to be there before he can even hear.
Yes.
So what are you hearing? Hallelujah. Kadabashat halaba. And the Bible said when they brought the minstrel and the minstrel began to play, then he said, thus says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. May you hear thus says the Lord.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Because it's a time to be revived. And sometimes I will say revive the fire. You only think it's spiritual. No. You can revive your marriage. If the spark, if the fire goes down, you can revive it. It's the same spirit that will give you romantic ideas. It's the same spirit that will make your words sweet and gentle. It's the same spirit that will make you submissive as a wife and loving as a husband. Revival is not just limited to spiritual. Even your emotion can be revived.
Yes.
Broken shattered traumatic emotion can rebuild. Suddenly, you have life. You have feelings again. Suddenly, you can laugh again and you can smile. Why? Because there's emotional revival. Your finance can revive. Makada brashe kete bosata. Your finance can revive. Can we be up on our feet tonight? Ladaba shanda brekete. You know where you are at. Tell God where you want the revival. Ladaba se takalabo shete. Tell him where you want the revival. Lekada breskili andadaba jete. He's here to hear. Hala. He's here to hear. Tell him, Father, this is the area that I want your revival fire to come upon me. That I want your revival fire. Ladaba shanda ladaba zete. This is the area of my life. Maybe it's a child you're standing for, or a husband, or a wife. Hey, the boss, or a career. You want it to be revived again. It's like dead, like the dry bones in the Ezekiel 37. Say, Father, revive me, Lord. Revive my marriage. Revive my health. Revive my finance. Revive my emotion. Revive my mind. Revive my children. Revive my job. Revive my family. Revive the fire in me, oh God. Revive the fire. I used to have the spark, Lord. I lost it. Revive it. I just used to have this joy and dance round about the house. I don't know what happened, Lord. I lost it. Revive my joy. Revive in my peace. I used to be at peace and I cannot sleep. Trouble turning up in there and worry, anxiety. Lord, revive my peace. Give me your peace again, oh God. Revive my glory. I used to shine wherever I went. Suddenly it looks like nobody notices me. Even no matter how gorgeously dressed I am. Father, revive my favor. Restore it. Open your mouth and talk to the Lord. Lekanda brekatala baba. Revive the fire on the inside of me. Let it become the fire upon me, O God. That men may see and glorify your holy name. Thank and bless you, Lord. We receive by faith tonight, O God. For the just shall live by faith. Thank you for that seed you have sown on our inside. It is sown, O God. It is sown to your glory. It is perfect, O God. It is permanent, Lord. We worship you for it. Hallelujah. Revive us, O God. The fire in us must not go out. We worship you. Our enemies must not have the last laugh. Revive our spirit of victory, O God. Revive the sound of our praise, O God. Revive, O God, revive. Thank you, Father. I want to worship you in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, we bless you. I have given your people the word you gave me. Honor your word. Watch over your word and perform it, O God. For the Bible says, so do you perform the word of your servants and confirm the counsel of your messenger, Lord. Revive that one who needs a touch, oh God, somewhere. You know that somewhere where it is. You know that somewhere. You know that thing that is too heavy, they can't even utter it, Lord. You know it, oh God. You see the darkness, Father. Nothing is hidden before your eyes. The Bible says the word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than two-edged sword. Piercing to the dividing asunder of joints and marrows and bone and spirit, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is nothing that is hidden before his word. Search us and X-ray us, O God. Search us, O God, in the place of our weakness, O God. Wherever our fire has gone, that is it passion in the marriage, Father, revive us again, O God. Is it our intellect, oh God? Suddenly our minds look like it's shutting now. We can't read and understand. Revive our minds, oh God. Hey, our abilities and potentials, Father. Are they drying? Visions are drying and dreams are not coming forth, oh God. Give us inspiration by your Holy Ghost. Revive our minds. Revive our visions again, oh God. Revive us, Father. Is it a health issue, Lord? What is the diagnosis? What is the prognosis, Father? Revive us by your quickening power. Let the healing virtue flow. From the top of our heads to the soles of our feet, to every artery and gland and cell and tissue, oh God. Every organ and bone marrow and blood vessel, oh God. Every delicate, intricate part of our bodies, oh God. Let the quickening power of God revive us to health. Revive us to life. In the name of Jesus. Revive relationships, oh God. Revive relationships that are broken, oh God. Mend them again, Father. Someone has given us sacrifice so much, Lord. Oh, they will not lose out. Send your revival power. Revive us, oh God. Revive us. May we not thirst in the midst of an ocean. Revive us. Cause our eyes to see you again, oh God. Cause our ears to hear you again. Revive our passion for you, our zeal, oh God. Our zeal, oh God. May the society not choke our zeal. Create for us the atmosphere that sets up our faith, oh God. The atmosphere of power. We cry out, oh God, for a revival. We worship you. Thank you, Daddy. We give you praise. You say, as we are speaking to your hearing, so you are doing to us. We have spoken one more time by faith because we believe that you're the prayer answering God. If you made the ear, it's because you can hear. Hear us one more time, O God. An answer also got from the horns of the unicorn because you are able. Thank you, O God, for testimonies. Thank you for the word that has gone forth. Your word will never return void. Oh, watch over this word performance, O God. Take the praise out of our lives. We give you glory. Thank you because we call it done. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Tonight. And may God pour back into you double what you poured out to us on tonight, Reverend Blessing, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.